This evening's public input session is your opportunity to share with us your thoughts on our flexible path. In a few minutes, I'll invite registered speakers to the microphone so we may hear your comments. To be registered, you must have filled out a form at the registration table between 5 and 6. If you were not able to register by 6, you may leave written comments by completing the written comments form at the registration table by 8:30 and leave your form in the written comments box. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce Paula Go Williams, who's our president and CEO, and you're going to provide an overview of the flexible path. And please allow Ms. Go Williams to give a presentation and hold your comments until registered speakers are invited to the microphone. So, Ms. Go Williams, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, hold on. So they know who I am. Do I have to stand behind the podium? All right. Even better. I want to be closer. Thank you all so very much for coming out tonight. Starting to get hot, and then we heard the thunderclouds come. But nicely, the weather has improved, and we are really happy to see this many people here tonight to hear about our flexible path plan. I'm going to cover highlights overall about the plan. I'm going to end with this, but I'm going to start with this. Please know that what this is a path forward. And I have people ask me questions all the time. So are we locked in? We are not locked in. Flexible was operative and important, because it gives us the ability to take in dialogue, it gives us the ability to take in input, look at new technologies as they develop, and we are very excited about the horizon of new technologies. It gives us the ability to keep making improvements. But what we have is a path that says, what do we know right now? What can we see technologically and still meet our objectives? And so we are glad to have input. We are glad to share. We have been out already doing some updates to smaller groups. And additionally, if you have a group that you would like us to share the tenets of our plan, the framework, we would be glad to honor that. We have many people in our company that are well-versed in it, and we can do that. So are you all going to help me with slides? Very good. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started in the interest of time so we can hear from you. I'm going to hit an overview of topics and who we are and why we're here a little bit more. I'm going to talk about our current operational dynamics. We're going to talk about a plan that we actually put in place about 10 years ago. And that plan was actually our first entry point in trying to create options and flexibility, to not stay on the same path that we've been on before. And now we're coupling it with a new update, a new upgrade that utilizes the focus on our Save for Tomorrow plan and helps us think more creatively about our generation portfolio and our supply. So that will bring us to some slides that help us talk a bit more about the flexible path. And we'll conclude with some of the outreach we even have for this summer, because it is about saving energy. We really want people to save, and we really want to make sure that that ability to save as a community actually will give us more flexibility to make the best decisions in the future. Okay, so we think about everything in terms of being here to serve you. We have been owned by this community through the City of San Antonio, which basically means you all own our company. So we've been owned going on 76 years. Last year we had a 75th anniversary, and the biggest thing that we wanted to do is celebrate our ability to make sure that we treat you like customers, treat you like investors, treat you like owners, because that's the way we see you, and your neighbors. We've also been in this business, in the energy business, for about 158 years. We had one time when we originated, there were only 8,000 people in San Antonio. And here we are today, and we take our position to serve this community absolutely serious. We say that we're here to serve you, and what we know is a flexible path forward. Next slide. Because our purpose is to think about how do we actually help you do the things that you want to do, live the dreams that you are trying to do. This has been a wonderful community for a very long time. CPS Energy is enabling. We don't come up with the businesses. We don't think about all of the new strategies and all those specific things. You and the rest of our community create it, and we basically are here to power your dreams. And if you haven't heard me talk about it, when I became CEO about 2.5 years ago, I thought, what's the simplest way for us to think about what our obligation is, our commitment, our passion? And we came up with people first. We are continually thinking about how do we do a better job so we can better serve our customers and better serve our community. And we want to engage you to make sure, again, we're listening more than we're talking, but we are trying to share what we're thinking about, how we're looking at solutions, how we're trying to move forward for our community. Because again, it's important that we recognize power is 24/7, 365. We've got to think about it in terms of making sure that we either minimize or eliminate outages. We know that those are a nuisance. We know that they're an inconvenience. We know how difficult they are. And we're spending more and more time thinking about how are we going to improve our system so we have less outages. We actually don't have as many as most other utilities, but we know they happen. Storms, we have a lot of electrical burning of our equipment when there are storms. All of that stuff happens, and we've got to recover quickly. So we are constantly thinking about how to stay on, how to stay reliable, and how to make sure that our gas is flowing as well. But all of that means that we got to be good stewards. So we focus on keeping our costs low as we can. We focus on making sure that we are not a burden. We make sure that when we create a program, we do our best to self-fund, and we are constantly focused on saving money. Our board, that's one of the things that they tell us constantly. Think about being passionate about saving money, because saving money saves you money. This is your entity. Said another way, I said you own it, you're shareholders. The way we look at it is these assets are the community's assets. We take care of them, we manage them, we maintain them, and we've got to make sure we do it as efficiently and effectively as possible. And service matters. We make sure that we are thinking about how are we going to change our business model and how can we ultimately do better. And we have been putting more people on the phones. We have created more programs. We have asked for more input so we can do a better job for you. Along that way, so we're focused on getting our employees in place. We're getting them gauged up for new learning and new technologies. And we're thinking about how can we be better contributors and better service providers. We, again, focus on taking care of your assets. And then when we do invest in new assets, what's the next best dollar spent on? And ultimately, can we create more programs like STEP that has rebate programs, weatherization programs, energy efficiency, and other types of things that we can do to help make your lives easier? And then we've got to also make sure that we are working hard to make sure that our emissions are reducing, we do understand that, and that climate is just as important to us as we know it is to you. I will say that this slide will be available, a set of slides will be available. We will post these. We will post them in the English and Spanish. And we will also post questions and answers because we want to continue to make sure that we are tracking what are we hearing and what are we going to do about it. But this is one slide that just basically says the numbers mean that we are aspirationally focused on getting better. We have been number one in the state of Texas in wind and solar, and we take that as a badge of honor. We have been greening up our portfolio for quite some time. We have been working on economic development initiatives, trying to help businesses come here and bring jobs here and be an economic generator, again, for the benefit of all of us. You've seen this slide. Again, we have a board that is here tonight, and they are very much on top of challenging us, asking us to really create more engagement and more interaction and really thinking about the future strategically. We're very happy to be here with them and so they can hear the same messages that we hear from you. And I will say, I will be going to work with the mayor. The mayor is going to have a live cast tonight, and we're going to sit and talk about the session. So the mayor's not here right now because of his conflict, but he is very much aware of what we're doing and very much interested in the feedback. Our chairman, Trustee Steen, basically talked about and introduced some of our community advisory committee members, which you saw here. We have 15. We have 10 assigned to districts. And what this slide does is indicate that every single council member has a CAC member. And the CAC members are the liaisons between the council members and us and the board. The CAC members, matter of fact, we have a meeting today. They came in today. They meet monthly on a regular basis, and then they are constantly out in the community. They spend time with our people. They're thinking about the things that we're thinking about, and they're giving us input. Extremely valuable body that helps us get a lot of things done. So let's talk about our operational dynamics. So I like to explain that we're in every aspect of the energy utility business. We generate power. We transmit it in big transmission lines. We move it through distribution lines. And then we deliver it to homes, businesses, and places for events. And that's what we've done for, again, 158 years overall. Primarily it was a gas system, but we grew into this. The issue, one of the issues that we have, is this has been designed to be a one-way system. Power just flows one way. And that's the way it's always been. But we recognize what's really happening is we now have an opportunity for more solutions close to the home, what we call the distribution end of the business. More distributed generation, more solar, more technologies, more energy efficiency to reduce the demand, and we welcome that action. We know that's the way to go. We know that people want to find their own solutions to a great degree, and we need to be flexible enough, and we will be, to allow for that, as well as be able to continue to deliver power the way that people don't want to think about what the specific solution is. We can do it either way in the spectrum. So it's important to recognize we're moving from a one-way to a two-way system. And at the core of this, particularly, I've been at the company for 13 years. At the core of this has been our generating systems. We have coal, we have nuclear, we have gas, but again, we have an emerging amount of solar and wind in our systems. But the way that utilities have made investments in the past is to build massive amounts of generation, and those assets are typically expensive. We find a way to make it economical. We can make $1 billion economical because we spread it over the system and we bring the cost down as low as possible per unit of power. But still, it's been a way that we've done it. The issue is those plants can last a long time. They're built that way. And again, the longer a plant lasts, the more economical that power typically gets over time. And that's the way that we've always solved growth issues. If you build it, they will come. And that's how, you know, year after year we were planning. Year after year we were planning. But we recognize, again, that that's not the way it has to be. And we've been able to defer some investments already by not automatically building a new power plant. I will talk about that shortly. But this also says, it kind of tells a story. A little bit hard to read. Again, we'll have this buildable. But what it really says is that big dark blue on this side of the chart, the big dark blue space, that was all coal in 2010. And we recognize that we were too highly leveraged in one type of generation. And so what you see now is a decreasing amount of fossil fuel. We're about to close the two Thiele units. They're older, they're harder to keep economical. We do keep them economical, but over time, they're harder to keep economical. And so it is just more effective for us. What we did was buy a newer gas power plant, a younger gas power plant, half the emissions. We've improved
our operational investments, and so we're moving to be better diversified over time. What you see in the on the 2020 graph is you see an increasing amount of renewables, more solar, more wind, more energy efficiency, and those are going to continue to be bigger parts of our portfolio. But I will tell you, here's a point. In the 1970s, we were all gas. We had no other type of sources of energy. But when we got to a big lawsuit, because gas was very volatile, but what we really learned is that it does not help this community to be focused on just one type of technology. We need multiple types of technology, so we have choices to help us keep costs down, keep them low. And so this is what we will continue to focus on diversification, and we will continue to look for new ways to generate capital. So STEP. What STEP is, it's again an ability for us to not spend money on a power plant and actually spend money to save money. So we support solar rebates, we support solar credits, we support community solar, energy efficiency, weatherization, and we are finding that all of those things are much better investments and they immediately bring demand in. We have a huge, what we call a demand response program. And what that means is that we can take thermostats and automate the ability to move the thermostat so we can reduce how much usage this community asks for. All of these things are rolling through our STEP program. And what this chart says, it's a better investment to put money into energy efficiency than it is to build a power plant. If we hadn't launched this back in 2008, right now I would tell you we would have built another coal plant. That's just what our mindset was. We knew that growth and demand was going to occur. But what we said is, why do that? Why not reduce consumption as much as we can, buy ourselves some time, and then let new technologies come forward? At the same time that we did this, that's when we put in more solar. We did a huge amount of solar, 400 megawatts. We were able to do that because we weren't worried about building another power plant. Not even. And this indicates that we continue to want to talk about that. So you have people around the room tonight. We continue to do what we call care fairs, where we'll go around town. Again, send us notes if you want more information. But we are really trying to talk to you about all the programs we have to help save you money by reducing how much power you're demanding every day. And it's working. We have been able to aggregate the reduction of power when we need it by you all working with us. We've got to have everybody at the table wanting to do it, everybody wanting to move from cold to comfortable, from being too hot in the winter to comfortable. And so if we're able to do this as a community, again, we'll be able to reduce how much investment we have to put in existing technologies. This is just a myriad of all the different programs that are within STEP. It's comprehensive, and we will continue to put programs in here going forward to make sure that we're meeting the needs of our community. What this just says is we look to make sure that the point of STEP is not just to put money out there. The point of STEP is to help change behavior for the cost that we put in. So the way I like to explain it is our first program were light bulb replacements. We moved to LED lights from CFL lights. But nobody wanted them at first because they were too expensive, way too expensive. So this program funded the ability, and we gave up 1 million lights. And by that time, technologies got better, and the price of lights went down, and people began to buy LEDs naturally. That's what we're always looking for. We're looking for that point where behavior and cost meet, and they bring the prices down, and we make better decisions. Do a couple of advancements. Give me two clicks. Okay, so what this is to show you, this is our investment in renewables right now. We have plants all across the state of Texas. We have coastal wind, we have central state wind, we have solar all over. We have solar in our certificated area here. We have small installations close to homes, and we have big installations. We believe that renewables are a way to with renewables has been that it still depends on weather a lot. What's going to change that is energy storage or some other technology that maybe we don't even know about. And when we do, it's going to up the efficiency of the renewables, and it's really going to be a game changer. And we expect that to happen, and we make spend a lot of time looking at the development of new technologies, so we'll be able to take advantage of that as they develop. So questions? Again, I want to indicate, we have been on a program for a very long time. This is not the beginning, it's kind of just the next step, because we have decided we're going to close coal plants and reduce the emissions by half. We're going to reduce and improve fossil fuel quality. If we have to use it, we'll do the quality. We'll put on the best emissions in our plants. We'll put more money into renewables. We did, again, 400 megawatts. At the time when we did the 400 megawatts of solar, nobody in the world had done a project that big. And it was a huge game changer for everyone. So that means that we've been able to do a lot of effective things to so far reduce our emissions significantly, increase our renewables, reduce all types of implications that come along with fossil fuel generation. And now we're putting in new technologies. We've got more air sensors. Working on the climate adaptation plan to look at how can we work with the transportation issues as well as the energy issues. How can we look at everything comprehensively and make progress along the way? And we're on the path to making progress. What this slide says then, again, right now, the reason why we've been able to put renewables in so effectively is because we have well-performing thermal power plants. That's just the truth. And because we knew that we were bringing those costs down over time, we've been able to put in a significant amount of renewables. And that's helped us. But we're looking at new technologies now. Again, we're looking at energy storage, battery storage, any type of new chemistry that might be the right chemistry for us. Because we think that's a better partnership with renewables than we have with thermal plants. It's not done. There's a lot more technology, a lot more research. A lot more standardization has to come forward to make the price point right, to make sure that we are being careful with your money. So the flexible path sets goals, but they're inherent. They say this is what we can do with what we know now. That's what it says. But please know that we believe our community, particularly through our owner and you, we should be thinking about aspirationally what our goals can be. And when those goals are set, CPS's responsibility is to manage to get to those goals. But we are a bunch of engineers and analysts, and so we have to figure out how to really get it done. It can't just be aspirational. It's got to be what can we do now, and how can we make it as affordable and quick as possible. So we're on a journey. That's what the flexible path is. How do we move from specific abilities to aspirational goals? And that's our responsibility, and that's what we'll move forward, and we are listening. I will tell you about one project. We are working with Southwest Research Institute. We are about to put in a new battery storage project right along their campus. That's really critical because it'll allow us to put that technology in there. We were able to get a grant that brought down the price of that, and it's making it very economical. It's only about 10 megawatts of a one-hour battery. It can be converted to 5 megawatts of a two-hour battery. But it'll help us make another good step forward to find a way to really put more technology into our systems. So here's a slide that really has caused probably a lot of frustration. And what it basically does is it shows where we were in 2010. And what I want to highlight for you is in 2010, we had a whole lot of gas and coal, the gray and the dark blue. Nuclear continues to get more and more efficient, but as we grow, we're not expanding into any more nuclear. I know I'm going to get that question. No more nuclear. But we do have fossil generation in 2010. But when you get out to 2040, with what we know today, what we see is you still have nuclear, you do still have some element of coal and gas now, because that's what we can see. We don't have a replacement today, but we know that we are listening. What can we do in the future? And that's our journey. But significantly, 70% of our portfolio will either be some type of renewable energy storage or advanced tech. And if you think about non-emitting, 80% of it with nuclear will now be non-emitting. That's an advancement forward. Again, we understand that the goal would be no emissions. And we are open to that. But again, this is our first view of what would it look like. The substantial part of this, again, is this is extremely different. 5 years ago, this would have all been, if you see that second to the last arm, look how much blue and gray we would have had if we had stayed on that original path. And we're not on that path anymore. So strategically, we made a huge shift to get there. And that's one of our first steps as we move forward into the future. This is just another way to look at it. This kind of shows the journey. But again, that look at the center on the far right-hand side. Look how significant the blue is. That was what we were going to do with gas. We won't need to do that under the flexible path just with the technologies we know now. And again, we have a future that says we can do other things as well. This is a graph that shows the reduction in our emissions. Carbon, SOx and NOx, we have significantly brought them down already. We will bring them out again when the DD plants close. The flexible path takes our emissions down further. And please understand, we will continue to look for new ways to reduce emissions from our plants. And we are working with the city to think about, again, how can we help transportation? How can all of us help transportation? That is actually a huge driver of emissions. We're going to do what we need to do, and we're going to help overall in all the solutions that we have going forward. And what this basically says is we have a constant process. So we'll be out regularly. We'll be out every year telling what's the latest, what does the plan look like, and we have a process that basically says just keep challenging ourselves, keep listening, keep researching, keep looking at the new thought leadership. When we do that, we will get better and better over time. Because we have a path where we really want to meet all the needs of this community and do the right thing. And so this is kind of our visual about what life would look like if we could solve some of the generation issues that we have today. Okay, almost there. So again, this slide, this is all the outreach we've done in smaller groups around town already. Keep going. We are right here. This is a continuation of that, and then one more. This is where we are today. The top of the list is this meeting, and we will continue to schedule meetings to, again, share where we are and what we're interested in and getting your feedback. And at the same time, we're about to go into a really hot summer. I think you've heard. There have been a lot of plant closures in the ERCOT market. And so there's been a lot of pressure to focus on how to be really, really available with reliable power across the state. We have done all our maintenance. We have been tooling up everything. We're ready. Summers are really difficult. So you will hear more. And tonight I'm here to say, we need your help. Please think about conservation this summer. Please watch your advisory notices. Please sign up for our programs. Again, if we can keep our conservation controlled, it will be better for us, better for our community, and better for our state. And these are some of the outreach things that we've done on this program just so far. So, in closing, as we're about to hear from you, and thank you again for coming out tonight, we're committed to listening. This management team, I'm going to ask real quick, can all the CPS Energy people stand up? It's probably a lot. Okay. So, probably 2-1. Okay, thank you. So the point of that is these people are your liaisons. If you see us and you want to ask us questions and you want to engage in conversation, maybe we won't have all of the exact answers right away, but we want to hear of us to say, have you thought about that? What do you think? We want to hear more. We think you can really pursue some other options. All of those things, please share your thoughts with any of us. We will make improvements as we can. We will continue to be good cost stewards, and we'll tell you about how much things cost as we are thinking about those investments, and we will keep our flexible path flexible. So with that, thank you so much tonight. I will get out of your way, and I'm listening very intensely. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President. I should have asked this earlier. Can you all hear back in the room? Is everybody hearing fine? Those of you all standing against the wall back there, raise your hand. Can you hear good? Everything's good? And also, we got seats. If any of you all like to sit down, don't feel like you have to stand up. I'll explain the guidelines we'll use for the evening's public input meeting. And bear with me, I'm going to go through these. Each person interested in speaking must have a completed speaker's form at the registration table by 6 p.m. We have 46 attendees signed up to speak, and the maximum time limit per speaker will be 2 minutes. A registered speaker may cede his or her time to another speaker, but no speaker may speak for more than two other registered speakers. Only one appearance per speaker will be permitted. A digital timer will be displayed on the screen to alert speakers to their time remaining. After the allotted time has expired, the speaker will have 5 seconds to wrap up. I'll call a speaker's name 3 times. If there's no response, the person will forfeit his or her opportunity to speak, and the next speaker will be called. After I call the current speaker's name, I will also call the names of the next two speakers, and they may move up to the reserved seats in front. Where are those seats? Where are the seats in front? Right here. All speakers are asked to introduce themselves to the board and when they step up to the microphone, and also let us know if you're representing a group or organization. If a registered speaker is using time for other registered speakers, please also provide their names in addition to your name. There will be no signs or props other than the CPS Energy displays that any speaker may use to illustrate a point. Carrying personal signs or props could block the view of the audience. Sound machines and blow horns are also prohibited. Please be courteous so that we can hear each speaker without interruption. The speaker's time is limited, and any applause or talking from the audience will interfere with that allotted time. If you have comments but prefer not to speak, you may put your thoughts in writing by completing a written comments form available at the registration table. No person attending this event may delay, interrupt, or disrupt the meeting or refuse to allow a request from the board chair. Attendees will remain seated except for the person speaking at the microphone and registered speakers moving to the staging area. Please note that the meeting is scheduled to end at 8:30. If for any reason you do not get the opportunity to convey all of your input, we'll accept written comments throughout this evening. You may also put your thoughts in writing on a comment card and place it in the comments box located at the registration table. Okay, we're now ready to begin hearing from our registered speakers. The first speaker is Dr. James Spickard. And then, I'm thinking of my baseball, on deck is Dr. Meredith McGuire. Is this right, Dr. Guevara? And then, in the hole is Reverend Sylvia Vasquez.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Move forward. Right. And then you all in the back, raise your hand if you can't hear me. Go ahead.
Dr. James Pickard, I teach environmental studies and sociology at the University of Redlands. My concern is that we transition from fossil fuels as rapidly as possible. And so I wanted to make 4 very concrete suggestions that I did not see thoroughly in the plan. All of them have to do with current technology. 2 of them I know that utilities have been doing for 30 years. One of them involves identifying all of the industrial processes in the city that generate waste heat, working with those industries to set up cogeneration so that they can generate electricity out of that, and the extra electricity that is generated there, they then sell that to give to CPS at the 2 cents per kilowatt hour that we who have solar sell our assets to. The second one is something Los Angeles has been doing since the early 1990s. You put a little device on someone's air conditioner, and every so often when we get a high, one of those high use days, they can raise, they can lower the efficiency of air conditioner, lower that air conditioner so it does not draw as much juice. Los Angeles was able to avoid brownouts by doing that. We could figure out a way to save peak energy. Third, CPS works with industries that they want to bring to the city, and when you do so, often you provide some kind of some subsidy for them. As a trade, work with them to install solar on each of their buildings, and then take the extra energy. And then fourth, work with the city housing authorities to go into the neighborhoods where we are already subsidizing low-income people, help retrofit their houses so that they can meet the least solar, and they can benefit, and we can benefit simultaneously. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Mary Squire. Reverend Vasquez, you're ceding your time to Dr. Mary McGuire. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Thank you.
And then do I want to follow up Kimberly Ritter and Bernie Martinez? And go ahead, Dr.
My name is Mary McGuire. I'm a professor at Trinity University, and I'm co-chair of the Conservation Committee for the Alamo Sierra. Much for this opportunity to speak about CPS's energy resource planning. It's clear that the old model based on large-scale generation is obsolete, and I'm very pleased that CPS is working on a better model. Unfortunately, CPS is also stuck paying off the bond debt for inflexible decisions made a decade and more ago to build huge coal-fired power plants that weren't actually needed because the total demand stayed flat even after that Spruce 2 was completed. So the so-called Flex Plan proposes to keep that plant running through 2040 or beyond. I urge you to close all coal-fired power plants as soon as possible because we cannot afford the real total costs of energy produced from coal. Those are costs that the costs of harm to health, the cost of damage to the environment. Those real costs are not about price points. They're about the enormous harm to our community caused by high levels of air pollution and greenhouse gases. CPS Energy's fossil fuel power plants are significant sources of both those scourges. The people of San Antonio should not have to pay for coal-fueled air pollution with their health and their very lives. Too many children are suffering from asthma. Too many heart attacks and strokes are being triggered by ozone and particulate matter. Those are preventable. Fossil fuel is also a major source of greenhouse gas emissions. San Antonio is especially at risk due to heat waves, drought, and flooding. Climate impacts in our region will be serious enough to hurt our economy. If we want to make San Antonio climate ready, we must make the transition to renewable energy as quickly as possible. That is the path forward. I urge you to lead. It also, in addition to all of the other good leading the CPS Energy has done, I urge you to lead also in closing those obsolete polluting plants as quickly as possible in the next decade. A healthy San Antonio economy requires healthy San
you, Dr. The next speaker is Kimberly Britton, and then we've got Ernie Martinez, and then please, Alan Montemayor, please come forward.
Hi, good evening. Kimberly Britton, I'm the CEO of Epicenter, and for anyone who's not familiar, Epicenter is a nonprofit that is charged with transforming the old Mission Road power plant just south of downtown San Antonio and turning it into a new energy innovation center. And as CEO for an energy innovation organization like Epicenter, I have the advantage of a front row seat to innovation in this sector. It is true that energy technology is advancing at exponential rates. And the way we get our energy in the future will look quite different than it does now. That said, even for the savviest among us, anyone would be hard-pressed to predict exactly when the advancements like solar plus storage will catch up with the reliability and scale of current power plant assets. That is why I find the CPS Energy Flexible Path Plan both prudent and forward-thinking. It considers the mandate for reliability while allowing it to be a nimble institution that can take advantage of developments not yet conceived. Moreover, I applaud CPS Energy's openness and transparency in engaging in this public dialogue with the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I'll call for Ernie Martinez, and then we'd like Sean Kennedy.
Good evening. Ernie Martinez, partner with H2 Development Corporation and Energy Almonte. So, San Antonio is now home. I went to visit my mother, and she said he is only visiting, and he will be here for 5 days, and he is going home. So that means to me, I am officially in San Antonio. And one thing that's very important is that my daughter was born here, and I don't need to wait for Silicon Valley anymore to tell us what technology we need to bring to market. Because of my passion, and what brought you I left Rackspace to be able to bring energy renewables. We have a solar company, Energy Blanca, and we have now partnered and been working with hydrogen development, hydrogen refineries as alternative fuel sources, as well as alternative method for storing energy. And one thing that I would implore as part of the 5% storage to take a look at hydrogen storage as an alternate method for storing power, not just simply lithium ion batteries, especially looking at the life cycle of that battery. And second, if you look at the flex, the 60% flex of, that you have planned, to also look at hydrogen as being infused with natural gas so that you then optimize the kilojoules that you would deliver per that line, and then you can optimize and actually the longevity of the natural gas delivery as well. And so with that, I would say when you look at the battery technology, the $10 million, the 1 megawatt price point, Toyota headquarters has moved to Plano. And they created the Mirai, the hydrogen fuel cell car that is now being rolled out in California, New York, New Jersey. 10 Mirais can make, and actually 10 Mirai fuel cells can deliver 1.2 megawatts of battery storage. The price for those 10 megawatts for that 1.2 megawatt of energy storage will cost $600,000, and that's if you buy the car and strip out the fuel cell batteries. So if you look at that, we have Toyota in our neighborhood, and we have the technology we can deliver and engineer. So let's look at our neighbors to optimize. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. I'll call for Alan Montemayor, and then also have Chris Steele come forward.
Hello, my name is Alan Montemayor. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. I'll be very brief because there's a lot of people who want to speak. I stand behind the people here who want to see CPS Energy move more towards renewables and away from fossil fuels. However, I'm not going to speak about that tonight. I'm going to ask you for three specific things. The first is I want to see more cooperation between CPS Energy and SAWS. Pursuant to that, I would love to see CPS Energy and SAWS put a large solar farm out of the SAWS H2O facility. And it's a great use of energy out there. It's designed for to educate the public. And they have deionized water, which could be sprayed on the back of the panels to increase the efficiency to each and every board member if that's possible. So I'm not going to belabor the point. I'm going to move on to my next point. I drive an electric vehicle. I'm wearing my electric vehicle as shirt tonight. And I would love to see CPS Energy quickly move forward with the adoption of electric vehicles in their fleet and other fleets and adopt rules and regulations that increase the number of charging ports in San Antonio and also make it possible for people to charge at night when it would be beneficial to CPS Energy and beneficial to them. The third thing that I want to ask you is I would love to see more input like this. I would like to see citizens to be heard at each and every CPS Energy board meeting. If the Citizens Advisory Committee is designed to take input from the citizens, it does not work. It's deeply flawed. So I would love to also see the Citizens Advisory Committee meetings be open to the public, which they're currently not. And I really appreciate you guys taking the time to listen to us tonight. Thank you so much.
CPS has presented that plan, and we have embraced what we have heard. The Chamber is committed to supporting the long-term, cost-effective energy sources and policies that promote sustainability and economic growth for our community. Our Chamber has over 2,000 members representing over 500,000 employees in this community, and all of us are concerned about our energy efficiency, our energy costs, and our energy reliability. We believe the flexible path reasonable, reliable, and cost-effective, and those are three key factors in remaining competitive, not only in retaining businesses, but in recruiting new businesses to San Antonio. The Chamber has a long and strong standing partnership with CPS, and we appreciate the efforts to engage the business community and also the community at large, like we're seeing tonight in these types of discussions. We applaud CPS, the board, and also its leadership environmental stewardship and their commitment to sustainability. Thank you for giving us the opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy. Follow the microphone, Chris Teal, and then we want to have Russell Seal.
Hello, my name is Chris Teal. I'm the current chair of the North San Antonio Chamber of Commerce and the CFO for Altamont Inc. here in San Antonio. And as a business leader, I understand that you need to deal with previous decisions that were the best options at the time, but circumstances have changed and will continue to change. The FlexPath plan that you've set forward is a socially responsible and cost-conscious plan that we all can deal with. Power is an economic driver along with water and workforce. And this plan gives us the opportunity to be flexible and take advantage of changes that we cannot even understand at this point. It also allows us take advantage of the fiscal environment that is happening in other states who have not had the flexibility to deal with their problems, much like getting much of our incoming workforce and jobs from California and other places who are not fiscally responsible as they chase their need and desire to be socially responsible. So as chairman of the North Chamber, I just want to offer you the North San Antonio Chamber's unanimous support, and we look forward to future collaboration.
Thank you, Mr. Deere. Call for Paul Martin, Sr. And then I need Dr. Carlos Garcia to come forward.
Yeah, the name correct is Raul Martinez, Jr.?
I'm sorry, Raul Martinez.
to talk about hydrogen. I don't have a lot of time, but as my brother mentioned about hydrogen, we have a company called H2 Development Corporation. We plan on building a hydrogen refinery here in Texas. We have found land. We're going through land clearance. And it really ties into what CPS is doing with renewables. At one point, X amount of investment in sun and in wind, you'll have overproduction. And you've got to store that energy somehow. And there's only a few options for storage. Hydrogen is a very viable storage system. It's been proven. There are plants being deployed in Australia, Europe, Africa, for using as a renewable and then returning it back as an energy source. And the energy source would be using a system called a dynamic combustion chamber. This is the hydrogen with the oxygen being reinjected into a vacuum, bringing it up to 5,000 degrees steam. That would produce energy turning a steam turbine. The steam turbine would turn a generator, and that would reinfuse the energy back into the system. So if anybody wants to know more details about this, they can download the entire white papers from our website, H2Dev. That's H2DEVCO.com. To help, and maybe we can. If anybody has any questions afterwards, I'm available. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'll call forward Russell Steele to the mic, and then if Michael Fry could come.
And I'm going to take the minutes from Karen's here.
Yes, sir, I meant to say that. So you've got time that was seated by Karen Steele, so you've got 4 minutes.
Thank you very much for meeting with the public and environmental stakeholders. Again, my name is Russell Seal. I'm a retired pharmacist, and I have been an activist with the Alamo Group of Sierra Club since, I guess, about 2006. And we have come a long, long way since then. I really appreciate our meeting with the CPS Energy leadership over this very many years now, and I hope that we have really applaud a lot of these visions of the recognition that climate change is real and we have to do something about it, and we have an ozone problem in San Antonio and we have to get a lot more done about it. And a lot of these are very good first steps, but we can do a lot better. One of the things that hasn't been mentioned is time of use. People have to recognize our customers, our population, need to understand that all of our energy at the time of one time of the day is not the same. We do not need to wait any longer to get time of use rate structures adopted. Y'all can get this process started this year. That is the key to get the public educated, to get the price signals, the price points, into knowing that the sun is not providing power at 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock in the evening, and the wind doesn't kick in at night. And the wind is virtually free during the nighttime. And as Dr. Buster has pointed out, maybe we should be giving away energy free at nights and weekends and then having premium pricing at other times. We don't need to wait. We can get these fossil fuel plants shut down and stop paying a high maintenance cost and bringing coal in from across the country much, much quicker than what this is, what has been proposed. If we're not, we can't run these Spruce One without the technology to get the nitrogen oxide SCRs on those plants. You're going to have to spend that $100 million, $130 million,
to put to the community. When you built Spruce 2, y'all made the promise that you were going to put the control technologies on Spruce 1. We've advocated, please don't do that. Don't spend more money on this old technology. It's our position that we can figure out a way to shut them down sooner. If you're going to go forward with these, we're going to have to spend that money on it. So please, educate the public. All of our energy is not the same. We can do this now. The public will embrace this. I'm very confident with the Nest thermostats and smart thermostats. This building is too cold. How many people are cold? Our buildings need to know when people are coming in. Our commercial sector, much, much more needs to be done on this. Every time somebody has a conference or meeting, commercial buildings that are stores or empty buildings that are too hot, there are huge opportunities there, and we cannot neglect our most vulnerable populations. As a pharmacist on Barbac and Military for 20 years, I saw the impact on our air quality, on our ozone, what it is. It's a real problem we have to address. CPS Energy is not the only producer of NOx, which but they can be the leader in getting it down with all of the things that are proposed. The key to get it started is time of use. Please adopt it.
Thank you, Mr. Seaton.
Call for Dr. Carlos Garcia
and ask Dennis Roberts to come forward.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Carlos Garcia. I'm the Dean of the School of Mathematics, Science, and Engineering at the University of the Incarnate Word. But more importantly, I'm also a member of the San Antonio Climate Ready group. So I want to make sure that I'm very happy to see that a lot of the members of that group are here. It's nice to see them all present here. It's also very nice to see the members of the steering committee. I mean, it's good to see them here. I think it's important that they're here and they give the opportunity to provide input. But I also wanted to thank CPS for funding that SA Climate Ready group. It's an important group. It's working hard to get the job done. Mr. Doug Medlich, he's in the back. Lisa Lynn have kept us on track, and I think that we're going to accomplish our goals. I also wanted to mention a very exciting project that we've coordinated with in a partnership with CPS Energy. It has to do with deploying these very sophisticated pollution sensors throughout the city. Data is important to us. We want to make sure that we know exactly where ozone, particulate matter, volatile organic compounds, all of the NOx and COX and all of the other pollutants that contribute to unhealthy conditions in our city, that we're able to deploy them all over the city, and that we're able to then build these sensors so that they're able to capture and give us some very accurate readings of where exactly our pollution is located in our community. So I wanted to mention that also this afternoon, and it's a very good, strong partnership with CPS Energy that we're able to build those ozone pollution monitors now. Those students at UIW in the Department of Engineering have called that project the Project Icarus. And if any of you are familiar with Icarus, it's the mythological Greek individual who decided he was going to fly with feathers, and then he got too close to the sun. So Dr. Michael Fry, an associate professor of electrical engineering, is going to follow, and he's going to talk about another exciting project. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
And then we'd like Beto De Leon to come forward.
Good evening. My name is Michael Fry. I am an associate professor of engineering at the University of Incarnate Word. And I just wanted to take a little time today to highlight some of the ongoing work that we have at my research lab, the Autonomous Vehicle Systems Lab. We are investigating the use of artificial intelligence and data analytics to help automate robots. One ongoing project that we have with CPS Energy is a very exciting program for us, where we're investigating the use of drones for power line inspections. And what's unique about the project is the fact that we're actually training undergraduate engineers and scientists to basically learn how to fly drones outside, working with the safety protocols of CPS, and investigate how we can utilize that technology with CPS to automate the inspection process a little more efficient. We're really excited about the project, and we just really want to applaud the support and the ongoing partnership with CPS, because we're basically addressing one of the really important San Antonio questions about the STEM pipeline. So we're actually engaging the community. A lot of the students coming in from the local school districts to UIW, getting them working on projects of local and national need. And we've been very happy with the ongoing partnership. Additionally, I'd just like to highlight the additional support of CPS for one of our middle school STEM programs, a camp that we have going on. This is the second of 8 weeks. And it's basically a free camp for girls, again, addressing a local community need of increasing the role of girls in both science and engineering. And we just really want to thank and applaud the enthusiastic support from CPS and CPS Energy for both of those projects. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. I'll call on Mike Dennis Roberts and call for Richard Pettis. So I'm glad that Dennis Roberts signed up. Okay, speak now. All right. Then we'll move on to Beto De Leon. And I'll call for Nancy Howard.
Good evening, my name is Beto De Leon, and I'm the Environmental Justice Coordinator for Southwest Workers Union. I just wanted to express some of my concerns around the flex path planned by CPS Energy and its continued use of coal and natural gas. Speaking out today because our community does not have time to wait for better solutions down the road. My family, friends, and neighbors in the west and south sides have continued to share their fears and struggles with asthma and cancer scares, all while living in the shadow of the JT Daly coal plant, and also the former Kelly Air Force Base area. If we're looking at a better future, we have to make sure that the weight of dirty energy is not being carried by any one neighborhood. We should be the leader in divesting from fossil fuels, utilizing all opportunities to plan new energy strategies with the support of City Council, public utilities, and community organizations who seek to make San Antonio healthier for everyone. As we continue to gather information and stories from our neighbors, as community organizers, we ask that we aim for sustainable, renewable energy goals such as coal-free by 2025 and fossil fuel-free by 2030. Our families, our community, and our city deserve better. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Governor. Call for Richard Pettis. And then ask to come forward Maria Roberts.
Chairman Steen, members of the CPS Energy Board of Trustees, my name is Richard Pettis. I am President and CEO of the San Antonio Chamber of Commerce, and I'd like to echo the comments of my Chairman of the Board, Sean Kennedy. The Chamber is very supportive of this flexible path plan. The presentation was very well done, and I think it makes a ton of sense. And I think if you just look back at where our city was 10 years ago, 15 years ago, if you recall, I was on the San Antonio City Council. And at that time, we were really focused on nuclear energy and all the benefits that nuclear was bringing to our city at the time. However, things have changed. Disruptive technologies are changing our lives by the moment. And so flexibility has to be a key component to our path forward, which exactly is what you presented. So we believe that our board of directors will be very supportive of the path going forward. At this point, we've heard nothing to give us pause, but a lot to celebrate. I'd like to remind everybody here in this audience that as a result of the excellent running of CPS Energy, a third of the city's general fund comes from the revenues that you all provide the city. That is policemen, that's firemen, that's roads, that's parks. Those are the things that enhance the quality of our life. So we want to say that we're excited, we're looking forward to the dialogue, and looking forward to supporting this path moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. I'll call on Mike Nancy Howard and call for Isaac Garcia.
My name is Nancy Howard, and I'm a technical recruiter. I've been a technical recruiter for many, many years. And I work with organizations really throughout San Antonio. I noticed that in 2025, Austin will be 55% renewable energy. And as a technical recruiter, I am constantly in competition with Austin. And even though San Antonio is doing a very good job, we're building fabulous apartments for young technocrats. We, are putting together a lot of resources to bring young technocrats to the city. Once again, when we're in competition with Austin, and Austin has a 55% renewable energy plan by 2025, This has to affect how people will think about the city. In the beginning, you said that CPS is a 24/7, 360. You have to begin to think that whatever it is that you're thinking, it has to be flexible because of the fact that energy is going to become one of the most important resources cities have, along with clean water, clean air. And I'd like to applaud CPS for having the lowest kilowatt hour. Very important, because that does bring technology companies here. And they are leaving places like California because it's expensive. But you have to be able to understand they're also looking at the renewable cost.
Call to the mic Maria Ramos and call for Romero Robles.
Buenas tardes, good evening. My name is Maria Ramos, and I'm part of the Southwest Workers Union, where we have been canvassing the south of San Antonio, where a TPR report shows that people on the south and the west of San Antonio live up to 20 years less than people in the north. And also, there are two major coal plants in San Antonio happen to be in the south of San Antonio. So San Antonio also has a high rate of hospitalizations due to asthma, higher than the average of the state of Texas. So what does that say about the city? Where a lot of children, actually four children in 2017, died because of asthma complications. These are like people's lives, people's health. So you talk about money to save money for people. And that also means shutting down these coal plants so people can have healthier lives. So they don't have to think about paying for the medication for their child with asthma versus rent or other utilities, the utilities that you provide. I'm also here because it seemed like although this is a community hearing, a lot of the people present are actual CPS employees. So as CPS employees, I'm asking you, the people behind me, to keep CPS accountable. To know that while you're working with CPS, you are also complicit. So when you go to work, it's also on your hands to ask the leaders of your company what they're doing, when they're gonna do it, and to keep them accountable. Because in the death of those four children, we're all complicit. So thank you very much for your time. And to the CPS employees, keep your company accountable, and please be present and make sure to ask questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle.
Jessica O. Guerrero.
Okay. When we get to you, then you'll have the comments. Okay. So then I'm going to call Romero Rosas, and then David Powell and Edward Castro. Should be.
Thank you, Chairman Steen, and thank you for your service also as our Secretary of State. My name is Ramiro Cavazos. I'm the President and CEO of the San Antonio Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. We're the largest private sector-funded business organization in the city. We're founded here in 1929. CPS has been the best investment our community, I believe, has made to provide quality of life and affordable energy and investment in economic development when it was, I know, acquired in the 1950s. And I believe there are five elements in economic development that are critical, and I believe that's why the CPS Flexible Path Plan is important. You need water, transportation, education, great leadership, and energy to have good economic development. In San Antonio, we are investors in two of those critical assets, water and energy, for economic development. Education is clearly an area of great interest for us from a workforce standpoint, and then we're catching up, I know, on transportation, and we have stable leadership and governance. So thank you for giving us this opportunity to speak this evening about the importance of continuing low, efficient, and affordable energy Your contributions to the community are critical, and you do more than most institutions do. Thank you for your support in also being a great partner on economic development. As I was Director of Economic Development for the city for 7 years, you all helped secure a whole new industry here with over 6,000 jobs, a whole new supply chain in automotive manufacturing with the super user rate, and also obviously with solar energy through us being the only community with a full supply chain with renewable energy. So thank you all for your vision. Thank you for your service as our volunteers and our mayor and your staff, and of course your great CEO, Paula Wolf-Williams.
Thank you, Mr. Kubala. And then call for James McVeigh.
Good evening. My name is David Howe, and I'm an intern with Environment Texas. I've lived in San Antonio for my entire life on the north side in District 9. I graduated from Keystone School in 2017 and am now attending Texas A&M University. I'd like to start by thanking CBS Energy for the many great things you're doing for clean energy, including work on shutting down the Dealey coal plant and the diverse solar programs like you have here today, helping get our city more renewable. According to Environment Texas's Shining Cities report, San Antonio is ranked first in Texas and sixth in the nation for installed solar capacity. This is great news, obviously, but we still have a lot more work to do. Burning gas and coal has not only polluted our air, water, and land for decades, it is now changing our climate even faster than scientists believed it would. We can have a healthier community right now and a livable future for kids and people like me growing up today. But to get there, we need to transform the way we produce and consume energy. That's why San Antonio needs to move to 100% renewable energy as soon as possible. It is a big and bold goal, one that would make San Antonio a world leader in the race towards a cleaner, healthier future. But it is very important to realize that it's a goal that is 100% possible. Here in Texas, the cities of Georgetown and Denton are already getting 100% of their power from renewable energy. And large cities around the U.S., including San Diego and Portland, have committed to get to 100% in the next two decades. San Antonio should wish to be one of those leaders and one of those cities in the nation to attract forward-thinking industry and the talented people that come with it. CPS's flexible path moves us in this direction, but we must move more quickly to get to 100% renewables. It is imperative that San Antonio gets to 100% renewable as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Howe.
Hello, Board. My name is Edward Castor. I reside in the Camino Madero neighborhood of District 8. I'm a ratepayer. What I'd like to say is that I appreciate all the information y'all put out on the website. I looked at it, and from what I can tell, it looks like a great, flexible path. What I've done is we have used the CPS Energy Savings Program, and everything that that technician has come to our house and said we needed to do to our home, we have accomplished. In fact, this month, we're getting ready to replace our single-pane windows with double panes. So the next step was, when I talked to the solar program, was that, you know, we're thinking about going solar eventually once we see what our bills look like. But I want to encourage y'all to please keep finding the funding for the solar programs, because like I said, that may be the next step that we want to do as homeowners. And one thing I'd also like to say is, y'all are future providers for this region. Y'all produce power, and you provide power. It's very important, because our region, the future depends on electricity and water. And with that said, you know, flexible path, to me, the distributed DER energy resources, that's very important. That's something we need to become more robust in. And I will volunteer my neighborhood know we're doing smart city. Let's do a smart neighborhood, Camino Bandera neighborhood. Come on out and put the infrastructure in for us. And also, next generation nuclear power. There are a lot of advances being made that needs to be in the mix. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gaffney. I'll call for the mic change, call for Alice Canisaro Garcia.
Hi, I'm James McVeigh. I'm with Ringstar LED. We're a manufacturer of LED lights here in San Antonio.
With McVeigh, you're kind of tall, so you're going to have to make you down.
We've been working with CPS since 2012 as an energy partner.
There you go. Thank you.
All right. Anyway, we just want to be here to show our support for CPS and the flexible path that they're taking. With LEDs, I think we've had the opportunity to put about 75,000 streetlights. In San Antonio, we've got thousands more to go. And as you know, LED streetlights, they save the city roughly 60% energy savings. And with those energy savings, we're able to help support the city as well as there's less energy being produced that helps clean the environment. So another thing I wanted to appreciate is most people don't know that the lights that are being bought in the city of San Antonio are made right here in San Antonio. So thank you very much for allowing us to hire employees here. We've got thousands of lights to put up, and we'd like to get them up quicker. There's thousands more to go. The more lights we put up, the more likely the employees we can hire here in town. But everything that CPS is doing, we're very, very appreciative of. And anyway, we just want to thank you very much for everything you've been able to provide for us.
Please do that, but we are recording all of this information, and so what we will do, again, we will post all the material from today, we will log the questions and the suggestions, and we will begin to talk about how we can take that input and really address it. So we will actually put that in social media, and then we will update our conversation to talk about the suggestions that we're currently hearing.
Thank you. Just wanted everybody to be reminded of that. Mr. Fuqua, please come here.
Yeah, my name is Wendell Fuqua. I'm a Sierra Club member, and I live in the Monta Vista area. As you all well know, and take justifiable pride in pointing out, CPS has developed a reputation over the last decade of being progressive in its energy. It has expanded its renewable portfolio and is reducing its coal portfolio. These are good things. Now you have a plan for the future, a flex path. You say this path is better than what you call a traditional path. Frankly, I think CPS has forgotten its progressive history. Your flex path is more like a traditional path. It is lacking in ambition or vision. In 2040, more than 20 years from now, your plan still contains coal, still contains gas, still contains nuclear, and is only 50% renewables. That's traditional, not visionary. Folks, at least 50 U.S. cities have committed to becoming powered 100% by clean, renewable energy. Among these are Atlanta, which plans to power all its city buildings using renewables by 2025. Among these are Boulder, Colorado, with a goal of 100% renewable energy by 2030. And among these are Pueblo, Colorado, with a goal of using 100% renewable energy by 2035. And U.S. News and World Report writes additionally, with nearly a quarter of residents living in poverty, Pueblo's leadership hopes transitioning to 100% clean energy will help stabilize costs and service. San Antonio leadership could take a lesson from Pueblo. I submit to you that these kinds of goals are visionary, not traditional, not flexible, but visionary. I would urge CPS to revisit its history and become far more ambitious in its planning.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. My name is Alice Canistero Garcia. I am a visual artist with NFAMIA, and I'm also a volunteer with Climate Action SA. Ms. Williams, you know, one of those ideas you want, like a new idea? One was posted on our website today, climateactionsa.com. It's a post showing a major freeway in Mexico. Mexicans are covering their highway columns with plants. It would help with greenhouse gas emissions. So, yay! One coal plant is closing this year. Dealey is closing in 2018. I really would like to know the date so we can plan the party. People throughout San Antonio are planting more trees, are transitioning lawns into xeriscapes or wildscapes, and conserving and conserving and conserving. We are transitioning from our current extractive economy to a resilient economy. Individuals are doing all we can do. All we are aware of at this point, as I see you all are doing that as well. We are searching for more ways to reduce greenhouse gases, we the people. We must reduce greenhouse gases starting, as Ms. Goldwater said, starting by not making them in the first place. Reconsider geothermal. Ms. Goldwater, yes, people first. People first is essential for a just transition to a resilient human civilization. I do, so now look at the time. Closing Dealey is good. Spruce 1 and 2 at 22 and 25, and getting out of gas by 2030. Two thumbs up. As Dr. Arjun Makajani says, let's become carbon free and nuclear free. In San Antonio, hay tanto sol.
Thank you very much.
So I'll call to the mic Jenna Sauceda Guerrero and call forward Jessica Guerrero. I think you're already here.
Well, good evening, Chairman Steen, other distinguished members of the CPS Energy Board. It's a privilege to be here. My name is Jenna Sauceda, and I am the CEO of the San Antonio Economic Development Foundation. We are a public-private entity that is charged with securing jobs and capital-producing investments for the San Antonio community. As you can imagine, we work in close partnership with CPS Energy on our corporate recruitment, retention, and expansion efforts. And as my chamber colleagues have previously mentioned, CPS Energy has and will continue to be an incredibly invaluable asset for our San Antonio community. But you're also a key element in each and every pitch that we share around the world. Just last year, we secured a Fortune 83 company in TJX, who will be adding 1,200 jobs on the south side of San Antonio because they selected San Antonio for their distribution facility, due in large part to CPS Energy's ability to provide affordable and reliable power. That is key, and your ability to maintain your cost competitiveness is key to our long-term success and health and viability as a region. So I commend you for your efforts to diversify your generation portfolio through your flexible path strategy and plan. And as a Southside San Antonian, I'm also very humbled and very proud that we are recognized around the globe for being a leader in solar and wind energy. But I urge you to continue to prioritize affordability and reliability, because the decisions that you're making today, as we've been discussing this evening, are long-term decisions. And again, your ability to be cost competitive is directly informing our ability to compete for new jobs and a long-term successful economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Call for Ariel Goodbye. And call forward now, Ariel.
Good evening. My name is Peter Bella. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you so much for making the time this evening. I retired from the Alamo Area Council of Governments in 2014 as Director of the Natural Resources Department, where we did ozone planning, both analytics and the policy development. And it was during that time, the 16 years I was at ACOG, that I also was able to get to know CPS Energy and a lot of other folks around the region who work with energy. But my comments tonight come from wearing two different hats. I am both on the steering committee for the Climate Action and Adaptation Planning process, and I'm a member of the Climate Action SA Group, which is a group of social justice and environmental justice folks who have spoken, several of them have spoken. And when you hear a thumbs snapping, that may be from them as well. My comments are that I appreciate CPS Energy's efforts, but I do believe that from the results we've seen so far in the draft greenhouse gas emissions inventory provided by Navigant, the consultant to the city for the climate action and adaptation planning process, even with all of the sustainability planning that, if it were to be put in place, that the city has thought in terms of approved, and even if the flexible planning process were place, all that by 2040, there would still be a requirement for, again, 41% greater reductions in carbon to reach the climate goals, the carbon reduction goals that the city approved when they signed the resolution in favor of the Paris Agreement. So that's why I'm with Climate Action SA calling for an end to coal-fired power production by 2025 and carbon production ended by 2030. I know it's ambitious, but I know that it's something for the sake of climate action we have to do. Thank you so much.
So I'm called it, is Councilwoman Sebelon there? Councilwoman Temple, are you here? You want to come forward?
Hi, this is awkward.
Would you like to say anything?
I just want to say thank you. Good evening, board, Dr. Mackey, Chair Steen. Thank you very much for being here and hosting this. And I just want to thank all the citizens that have come out. I serve on the San Antonio City Council, so just a little bit of a relationship with this board there. But I do want you to know that what's happening tonight is historic. I believe this is one of the, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but you actually have citizens being heard in front of the CPS board. And Dr. Mackey, when you were appointed, in an interview, I said to you, Dr. Mackey, this is something that's absolutely important to me. Will you please carry this forward if you become appointed? And thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Mackey, and the board, of course, Mr. Kelly, Dr. Mackey, for making this happen. I'm very pleased to see it. I think it's been very successful. And thank you to the citizens for participating and being here. Thank you
so much. So now I want to call Jessica Guerrero. And thank you for being patient.
Sure.
And you have 4 minutes.
Okay.
Because Isaac Garcia is seated this time.
Yes. I don't think I need all 4 minutes.
And then also I'll need their Bill Guerrero to come forward.
Buenas tardes, my name is Jessica Guerrero. I'm a member of Vecinos de Mission Trails, and we work closely with Southwest Workers Union, a local grassroots authority on climate justice issues. We are also members of the Climate Action SA Coalition. We join our neighbors and colleagues in demanding that CPS end their dependence on coal by the year 2025, and that you leave San Antonio and Texas in leaving all fossil fuels behind by 2030. We understand the implications of our demands, and we want to work with CPS energy officials to create measures that will address our demands without further burdening our communities. I am disappointed in tonight's absence of the mayor, our sole public servant representative on the CPS board, and except for Councilwoman Sandoval, whom I appreciate meeting here, I'm also disappointed that there aren't more representatives from city and county here. The very minimal mention of the CPS-funded Climate Action and Adaptation Plan as part of a pathway to public engagement is also very troubling. In the last 3 weeks, SWU, Southwest Workers Union, has led a canvassing effort that has found that 375 households so far support CPS leaving coal behind and switching to solar energy. And please listen to why. The communities we represent here are not only worried about their pocketbooks, they are also deeply concerned for the state of Mother Earth. The number one response people give when we ask if they prefer solar is, claro que sí, es más limpio, más, y es mejor para el medio ambiente. Of course, solar is cleaner and it's better for the environment. As you said here today, CPS is our energy company. Take notice of what our priorities are. We respect and we defend Mother Earth, and we look to save money in order to provide a stable future for our children and for future generations rather than basic upward mobility and wealth. Hear and heed the voices of our customers on our vision for healthy neighborhoods and a healthy future for our communities. Gracias.
I want to call to the mic Al Areola, and then note that Bill Greer, I think, departed and will not be speaking. So we need Karen Wheeler and Bill Sweet to come. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Al Areola, Jr., President and CEO of the South San Antonio Chamber of Commerce. On behalf of our Chairwoman Erica Gonzalez and our Board of Directors representing our 500-plus members of the South Chamber, we want to thank the team of CPS Energy for their outreach and engagement of our business community. Our organization has been offered opportunities to voice our thoughts and concerns regarding San Antonio's energy future, and we want to thank the team members of CPS for their transparency and inclusion in helping to determine responsible pathways to meet our community's energy needs. We continue to see technology exponentially change in obtaining optimum results and efficiency, and as we evolve into more renewable sources, flexibility is necessary for us to meet the needs and desires of our members in a responsible way. We are in support of the proposed flexible path and thank CPS Energy for their commitment to our community and members. We look forward to continued engagement and collaboration with you in building our energy's future. Thank you.
My name is Karen Wheeler, and I am a retired high school science teacher. And I would like to say, as many have said before, would like to get the, our plans for energy to be completely renewable and get rid of fossil fuels and to do it much more quickly. Whenever I bring this up, I usually get the car analogy. You don't go out and buy a car and take a loan for 5 years and then decide when you see a nicer, shinier car to go out and buy it and continue to have to pay the bills for the next 5 years. I understand that we've already put a lot of money into some of the power generation things that we have. But what if that old car is a 1971 Pinto and all three of your children ride in the back of it and they go down 35 where there's constantly needing to stop? I hope you guys know what a Pinto is. It's one that if you slammed into the rear of it, you could lose your whole family. Okay, now when you take a look at this, and this new Tesla maybe that you wanted to buy, or Leaf, or Volt, or some other electric car, all of a sudden it becomes a very easy decision. You would never put your family at risk like that.
you would figure out a way to get the car that was the safest. When the people come up here and talk over and over and over again about how imperative it is to have reliable and cheap energy because of all of the jobs that it brings here, remember that the algorithm for economics does not include health and does not include the environment, because those things are going to drag and pull down on the amount of money you can make. But what do you think that guy who cut the last tree down on Easter Island thought? Okay, you know, we have a wasteland now that none of us can live in, but boy, did we ever have a heyday and make money when we were doing that. So, this is when we need to take the prefrontal cortex of our brain and say, okay, we've run the numbers, we know what that is, but we need to look at the health of people and all living things, and if this planet is going to be able to sustain us. And that is something that human beings can do. That is the kind of planning that they can put forth. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. I'll call for the mic, Bill Street. I'll call for Timothy Hyman. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Dr. Bill Sweet. I'm a CPS customer, and I have rooftop solar photovoltaics. I am a scientist, and I spent the last the 6.5 years of my retirement extending my informal pre-retirement study of climate change using peer-reviewed climate literature. I also look at climate denier and skeptic websites trying to find substantive reasons to reject or minimize human causes for climate change. For my studies, I've given 5 talks on climate change to general audiences. I distill this to 3 points. 1, the climate system takes at least 1,000 years to equilibrate. Thus, what we do today affects the climate for a millennium at least. Yet analyses of climate change typically go only to the year 2100, 81.5 years from now. 2, analyses of the last 60 to 540 million years of actual Earth history show that in a few centuries, the global average temperature will be 9 Fahrenheit degrees hotter. That's without a further increase in atmospheric carbon dioxide. To stay within the climate's operational limits of the Holocene, that is the last 11,500 years, the only epoch known to be compatible with human civilization, burning fossil fuel, must cease by 2050. The good or bad future we hand to our descendants is directly dependent on the measures we implement over the next 10 to 30 years. Yet, in your 6 March strategic update presentation, coal-fired generation continues to 2042, a mere 8 years before the required zero carbon. Because renewables with energy storage are not economical, insisting on no climate cost options makes your kids and grandkids pay for your lack of interest in their future. Economists call this discounting the net present value of the future to 0. You are telling my 24 and 5-month-old granddaughters, who will live to see 2100 according to actuarial life tables, that their future is worth 0. Tell your kids and grandkids that tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Sweet. Call me tonight, Robert Miggins, and call for Brianna Barrera.
Hello. Thank you, Board, for the chance to speak. My name is Robert Miggins.
And Mr. Miggins, you might grab that mic, too. And just
sorry, thanks. Losing seconds by the second. I co-founded a solar company here in town. I'm a technology executive. I spent 15 years in technology here in town. I left behind that career 4 years ago to get involved with climate change, because like most of the people in this room, it's a serious problem, and I wanted to get on board to try to figure out how to be part of the solution. Having said that, I'm also a pragmatic person, and I've spent a lot of time understanding the different barriers that CPS is up against, one of which that's only come up a couple of times tonight is the price of power. And so when I listen to all the feedback, I guess my suggestion to CPS is to figure out how to always keep in mind that there is a bit of a push and pull between keeping the price of power affordable, especially for low and moderate income families, but at the same time, aggressively transitioning to renewable sources of energy. It seems to me that you're running that balance pretty effectively, given the barriers that you have. It's not easy to raise rates. You have to get city council approval, and that's not easy to do. So I guess I'm speaking in support in general of the flexible path plan, because I think you're up against some other barriers that have only come up a couple of times tonight. One suggestion is, I think if you give away a solar rebate, you should ask for something in return. I'm in the solar business. I'm a big fan of the solar rebate. I think you can ask for something in return, namely the ability to have visibility into those solar assets so that you can better manage your grid. And I think if somebody takes a solar rebate from you, one of my customers takes a solar rebate, they should sign up for a plan that lets CPS manage those assets for grid stability, which will save you money and help keep our prices low. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Call to the mic Timothy Brindley, and call for John Upper.
Good evening. I'm Timothy Brindley. I'm with OCI Solar Power. As you probably know, we've done a number of the larger solar projects for CPS Energy. It's been a great relationship. And so we were eager to see the flexible path plan. We were hoping to read more solar right now. And as we looked through the plan, it made more and more sense to us. There's clearly a commitment to renewables, which of course, as a solar development company, we're encouraged to see. But the reality, as we all know, is that renewables are intermittent and they need to be firmed up. And most of us agree that the future is solar plus storage. But the reality is right now, and we live this every day, there's no clear winner in the storage realm yet, nor has the cost come down where it needs to be. But it's going to happen quickly. So we applaud CPS for the work that you're doing with the Southwest Research Institute. We, again, believe that solar plus storage is the future. In the meantime, those renewables need to be firmed up. They're intermittent. And we believe that using the existing generation fleet to firm it up in the interim until we can get storage commercialized is the way to go. So we applaud the program, and we hope it comes to fruition quicker than anticipated. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm call for Brianna Barrera. And I think, Ms. Barrera, your speaking time will be 4 minutes.
Yes.
Because Justice Levin, is that correct? Seated time to you?
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
My name is Brianna Guerra, and
I need, before you go on, I need to call forward. We'll do that. Sarah Fautenberry.
My name is Brianna Guerra, and I am a climate justice organizer with Public Citizen and a member of Climate Action SA. There is an economic case, a public health case, and an environmental case to be made for transitioning to renewable energy. That is why we are calling for the retirement of the Spruce coal plant by 2025 and a full transition away from fossil fuels for electricity production at CPS Energy by 2030 at the latest. This is the right path, and there is an immense amount of research, data, and public demand in favor of transitioning to renewable energy. The flexible path is simply not enough. In fact, almost no additional renewable energy is slated to be added until nearly 2030. We do not have time to waste. The action we take or don't take in the next decade will affect us and those who come after us into the next century and beyond. Now is the time for urgent, equitable action. Coal and natural gas are not reliable, safe, secure, or resilient energy sources. They are toxic, dangerous, and killing our low-income communities and communities of color. The 2016 Bexar County Community Health Needs Assessment reported that residents in the South Side have a much shorter life expectancy, sometimes by nearly 20 years, than those living on the north and northwest side of town. The coal plants are on the south side of San Antonio. CPS Energy's website cites a focus on improving air quality for the community, but it is evident that many in our community still suffer. In San Antonio, around 335,000 people live in poverty and are at a higher risk of not having access to electricity. This is a health risk. Almost 14 out of every 10,000 children are hospitalized with asthma, compared to the state average of 8 per 10,000. This is a health risk. Roofers, landscapers, and construction workers labor outside in sweltering triple-digit temperatures for almost 60 days out of the year. This is a health risk. Our health, environmental well-being, and energy use are related in ways we cannot ignore. There is no need to choose between affordable energy and clean energy sources. They are one and the same. Several studies have pointed to the fact that the Spruce coal plant, like most coal plants, isn't economically viable. This isn't likely to change. Wind and solar are pushing coal plants and even natural gas generators out of the market. They offer the opportunity to lock in affordable prices for decades. Businesses are taking advantage of these favorable economics and so should CPS Energy. There are many other costs from continuing to burn fossil fuels. Climate change is accelerating and local air pollution is at unsafe levels. People will continue to suffer, be hospitalized, and die unless we take action, immediate action, to transition away from fossil fuels and to renewable energy. While CPS Energy can't fix the climate crisis on its own, it must do its part and do it quickly. We need a clear path forward to completely phase out fossil fuels as quickly as possible. Fossil fuels will continue to cost taxpayers. They will continue to harm communities. They will continue to destroy the environment. But we can change that. Public Citizen and the Climate Action SA Coalition are ready and willing to work with you, to labor alongside of you in the larger San Antonio community, to usher in a new era of renewable energy, of energy democracy, and of equity for all San Antonians. We, the community, will continue to fight for what's right because this is an issue that we all have a stake in. This is your home, as much as it is ours, and we are asking that you stand with us in our efforts to create a better future for our planet and a better future for all that call it home. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Father, the mic, John, and call forward Fernando Diego.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman of the Board. Thanks for the minute or two to say a few words here. I started the utility industry about 25 years ago, working for a large utility in the Pacific Northwest. At that time, the modus operandi was really to build large coal and large gas power plants. And that was the common trend for all utilities at the time, and the world has changed a lot since then. In the subsequent 25 years, I got involved in mergers, acquisitions of utilities, and was buying and selling these companies around the world, and got to know kind of how utilities work, how they function. And the commonality across them has been the use of capital, how to generate revenue, how to serve your customers, how to deploy reasonably and responsibly the capital that you have at hand. What I appreciate about CPS and this flexible plan is that it is comprised and made up of the people of CPS, which I have had the pleasure to work with. And I currently have the position of regional head of ITRON Network Services. And the whole, if you look, take them one by one, each of the employees that I have worked with at CPS all believes they all have children, they all have ratepayers, they all have the same issues that you and I do. But at the end of the day, their view is to take responsible decisions on behalf of the community, on behalf of the company, to use the capital that they have wisely, to deploy as best they can. My role at Itron really is to promote smart cities and smart grids, and I'm excited about the future and about how CPS is looking to utilize their existing assets rather than make new investments. And by utilizing what was mentioned earlier, the environmental sensors, dynamic lighting sensors in the smart city environment, there's exciting days ahead for us as a community, and thank you, CPS leadership, for your leadership.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to call to mind Sarah Fottenberry and call forward Klaus Wiesler. Are you Mr. Diego?
Yes.
Is Sarah Fottenberry?
I'm right here.
You're next.
Okay. Sorry. Hey, I'm Sarah Fottenberry. I consider myself an environmentalist, both professionally and personally. From a professional perspective, I work for a software company that allows utilities to manage distributed energy resources, pretty much everything outside of your traditional generation, including coal. CPS Energy is one of our customers. And personally, I also am an environmentalist. If I could rip off my roof and put solar and batteries, I would do that, but I have a roof, and to have two young kids, and I have to keep my costs down. But I do things that I can help reduce my carbon input. I do things like composting, I buy energy efficiency lighting, I recycle, I participate in utility programs that allow me to reduce my energy consumption during times of peak demand. I do what I can do. And I support the flexible path because CPS Energy is leveraging their existing assets, but also paving the path with innovation, incorporating renewables, as we've seen them migrate their portfolio from nuclear, gas, coal, over to renewables as well. So I'm in complete support. San Antonio, if you look at it, it's easy to look at it from a city perspective, but in the utility or the industry in general, CPS Energy is known as being an early adopter and paving the path for the industry. Just a little over a year ago, they won an award at a conference called DistribuTech, the largest and most recognized conference in the utility sector for the innovative program of the year for their demand response management program that incorporated smart thermostats and all of their demand response portfolio. So not only is CPS Energy's Flex Plan supporting lower rates for their customers, but also paving the path for innovation in the utility sector in general. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now, Mr. Diego, the chief of the mic, and I'd like to call forward Terry Burns.
It's an hour to my bedtime, so I apologize if I jumped the gun. I am here this evening to speak on behalf of the Real Estate Council of San Antonio. I had the honor to have served on the Mayor's Utilities Task Force and currently chair the REXA and the CPS bi-monthly meetings. With that being said, I have had the opportunity to work with CPS representatives hand-in-hand, really in the trenches through these meetings towards you know, trying to find solutions to the issues we commonly face with our city's growth. I can say that working with the CPS representatives, our city's energy company is in great hands. Technology is rapidly changing our lives, the way we do things, and renewable energy was maybe 10 years ago something that we just thought of as too expensive and just kind of way out of our reach. Well, it's now here. We see solar panels on a bunch of our roofs. We see wind turbines all over the highways, and for that reason, I commend CPS for being proactive and moving forward and developing a flexible path. With that being said, on behalf of the Real Estate Council of San Antonio, we are in full support of CPS flexible path.
Thank you, Mr. Diego. Call to the mic, Klaus Westbrook, and call forward Greg Harmon.
Good evening, Chairman Steve and other council members. Paul, I'd like to thank you on simplifying your message. It's very clear. Thank you. fully understand. CPS Energy has a long history of working with the community, business leaders, community activists, and customers. The discussion on the flexible path is no different, and we commend the board and the leadership team in hosting a public input session as this. San Antonio and the greater region is growing every day. New residents and businesses are coming to this region in record numbers, and it's important that CPS Energy plans accordingly, as they do, to meet the energy and gas needed to power the future of San Antonio for the generations coming. Recently, we learned that CPS Energy is poised to support the electrical demands of Texas this summer, and that is because a thoughtful and measured approach to planning the generational assets that we have in the power plants that are currently in place. CPS will be here to support ERCOT. I don't think the coal area applies. CPS Energy Smart Grid has allowed for the opportunity for other energy savings to its customers. They are not pioneers, but rather allowed for the technology to be mature and mitigate risks to its customers, thereby again reducing costs. At a current 98% deployed with the smart meters, customers will see benefits of this deployment, and because of the company and the board's measured approach, those customers that utilize the benefits of the smart meters are able to monitor and lower their own energy costs. CPS has empowered us all. As with the flexible plan, the best available option that makes sense for customers' needs takes into mind the impact of the environment, keeps costs as low as possible, which is key for our most economically disadvantaged, and most importantly, keeps the lights on and our businesses operational. Stay the course, let the technology unfold, and be open-minded to what the next fleet of traditional generation looks like, inclusive of more solar, wind, scalable battery storage, and whatever else can be conceived as technology will continue to advance. It amazes me that we live in one of the fastest growing cities in America and have been able to reduce our production as well as our emissions during this time. Please keep up the good work, and remember that a flexible path keeps open all of our options. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Weisberg, thank you so much for all the volunteer work you do with the Citizens Advisory Council, and appreciate it very much. So I'm going to call forward Terry Burns to the mic, and call forward Kevin Lutton.
Good evening. My name is Terry Burns, Dr. Terry Burns. I'm a pathologist with a long interest in environmental lung disease, and I am also the chair of the Alamo Sierra Club. I very much appreciate the opportunity to speak, especially to the board, I hope in the future the Citizens Advisory Panel will be open to input as well, and I really would welcome the opportunity to meet more with all of the board members, and appreciate your service to the community. I thank CPS for its long collaboration with environmental stakeholders and its previous support for renewable energy. However, basically with Spruce 2, you weren't being very flexible when you invested in what we should probably recognize as an Edsel, or maybe a Corvair in 2010. You are now stuck with a stranded asset of $1 billion that you want to pay for over the next 30 years. And as we heard earlier, would you put your family in a Corvair right now? Hopefully not. This is unsafe at any speed, and it's time to, as quickly as possible, shut down Spruce, both of them, as well as the natural gas plants, because of this extreme climate change situation we have now entered in, thanks to Lamar Smith and other successful fossil fuel lobbies. I'd really like to mention your rate structure, which is a real problem, because right now you're focused on selling energy to make a profit. And of course, keeping energy rates low is good for all of this business development everybody likes. But you have to uncouple these rates so that you can have more encouragement for conservation, energy efficiency. These are the things for the future we need much more of, even more than more renewable energy. We need more energy conservation, energy efficiency. And we need to uncouple this rate structure. It's extremely important. Right now, last year, American Council for Energy Efficiency Economy ranked CPS in the bottom 10 of 15 of 51 major utilities for energy efficiency. We can do much, much better. Please, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Marks. Call for Greg Harmon, and to the mic.
I think I've got Drew O'Brien's 2 minutes.
Yes, sir, thank you for reminding me. So you've got 4 minutes because you've been exceeded time by Bill O'Brien.
Okay, thank you very much.
Before you start, I need Dana to spot you with it.
Okay, thank you. I want to start just with a kind of a side note. There was a comment made earlier tonight that we're all on the same side when it comes to climate. And I think that's not actually the case. I think that there's the realist, severe analysis that's in line with science, and then there's the comforting side that we're doing what we can and within the limits of practicality. And I want to speak to that a little bit about setting a goal as a board and then making it work. You know, the moon launch was Sputnik, it was JFK, we're there on a date, and make it work. And I would love to see a decision at the board level or at the council level, the mayor step up and just say, we're getting there. Because I think there's a lot to that when it comes to we decide that this is our future and it's the future we want to live in. But for myself, I wanted to comment just to y'all as individuals, you know, that I remember, you know, growing up, you know, I would play in these, you know, wastewater canals or whatever they were, you know, and it was like a great adventure, you know, it's your own little forest, you don't know what you're running in, you're not asking too many questions, and you're not aware, you're not growing up to distrust nature or policymakers, you don't know what they are, and you know, the people that have kind of control over your environment. But after, for me, my daughter was born, I began to ask a lot more questions. I understood that dirty water, bad air, had a direct consequence for her. As a journalist of 15 plus years, I met many, many people who had direct negative interaction with industrial pollution, people who were displaced, sick people, poison water, cancers that no one could ever seem to find a causation to contribute. But while well-intentioned in meeting its charge for reliable and affordable energy, as y'all have rightly been praised for as a utility today, we've also unwittingly fallen into the same pattern of poisoning the ones that we serve. The unintended consequences of shifting to coal, you know, 40, 50 years ago, has been disastrous for the public health. And now we know even more. And, you know, I'm not here to convince y'all of the urgency of climate accelerated climate violence, because I know as representatives of this utility, as those who are responsible for half of all the greenhouse gases that are released in the greater San Antonio, that y'all are well-versed on this, that you've done your due diligence and you know where we are. But I am urging us to move past the flex plan and act like we do understand that we're an extreme hazard, an extreme point of risk. As certain as we are that smoking causes cancer, we know that burning fossil fuels has radically damaged the planet's life support system. And we know who will be bearing the cost of that reality, and it is the poorest among us. And so I am asking y'all to meditate upon this when you go home in the course of your work around the house, that the damages we're talking about, we've talked a lot about San Antonio, that our utility is responsive to San Antonio, the needs of San Antonio, but our impact is global. The 10 million metric tons of greenhouse gases pumped out every year, well, we're going to subtract DLA's 2.7 of that. That's not only hurting people here and driving, warming the Gulf, driving bigger hurricanes,
extended drought, all the rest, but it's hurting people, the farmers in the valley, campesinos through Mexico and Central America. It is playing into the loss, the crops in Syria that led to more people going to the cities and finding no opportunity, and this cycle that goes on and on. So I just ask that you look at that and think about your obligations beyond just San Antonio, beyond your family, because our family is global, and our response needs to be, and there are opportunities, if we take them, to be a visionary utility, to make this city one that serves the entire world. Believe me, people will come, not to fill out and demand more 3,000 square foot homes and higher utilities, but they'll come to serve. And as Climate Action SA, the Sierra Club, myself individually, will be there with you. We've been here a long time. I know you've heard from us many, many times before. We're not going anywhere. Thank you for your service and consideration.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Call on Mike and call forward Miguel Gallegos.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity, Mr. Chairman, Board, to speak to you this evening. My name is Kevin Lochner. I'm Vice President with Franklin Energy. Franklin provides grid optimization programs that leverage next-generation energy efficiency, demand response, and distributed energy resource programs. We have experience nationally with over 150 utilities. Currently, we work in partnership with CPS Energy as part of their Safe Maryland Energy Efficiency Program in Casa Verde under the umbrella of STEP. With CPS Energy, we've enjoyed our business relationship since mid-2016. Our partnership with CPS Energy has allowed us to jointly create significant value and lasting impacts in all the communities served by CPS Energy, delivering real energy savings to thousands of San Antonians, which is good for the environment and saves money. With an office located in San Antonio, we're also contributing to local economic development. With over 30 employees, not including engagement of local trade allies, contractors, and retailers, the programs create a real positive impact environmentally, but also particularly to low-income participants, who we receive hundreds of positive responses from. Our programs include home energy assessments, school education kit programs, weatherization for qualified families, rebates, new construction, and retail programs. In the last 2 years, we have installed energy-saving measures in nearly 27,000 single and multi-family homes, such as the gentleman earlier, weatherized 6,500 income-qualified homes, provided education material and kits to over 26,000 students and their families, and processed over 15,000 rebates for energy-saving equipment. These programs have contributed to helping CPS Energy and the community save approximately 60 megawatts in the last 2 years as part of STEP. In San Antonio, we see lots of energy efficiency opportunity. We're excited about its role in a cleaner, flexible, and affordable future for San Antonians, and we support the plan that's been presented. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight and the opportunity to partner with CPS Energy.
Thank you. Thank you. And call forward Roman Sokopoulos. Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
Good evening. I'm Dana Spotswood, and I'm speaking to you this evening as a parent and somebody who volunteers with children who wants to do right by that generation and generations yet to come. We learned during the Paris Climate Talks about the consensus that scientists hold that we need to keep 80% of known fossil fuel reserves in the ground if we're to avert catastrophic increases in our global average temperature. I would echo the pleas others have made this evening to adopt the more ambitious goals of closing all coal-fired plants by 2025 and going completely fossil-free by 2030. I have a question about the electricity program. When I moved here 10 years ago, I voluntarily signed up for a program where we pay a small surcharge every month to ensure that our households' energy uses are offset from non-renewables to wind, and we got this really cool sign that we proudly displayed in our front yard. And a few years ago, it disappeared, and when I called CPS to get a new one, some of the employees I spoke with didn't even know about the program. Others said that they would take care of it, and I never heard anything back, never had any sign. So I'm just wondering if that program still exists, and if it does, why are you not putting more to promote it, not just among homeowners, but with businesses, so that we can support businesses who support
renewable energy. Lastly, I had an idea that I learned about from Fort Stockton, which is the creation of a renewable energy park where people and especially children can come and see up close wind turbines and photovoltaic panels and learn about the futures that they can have in careers in renewable energy. I saw on your website that you're listing coal as both abundant and affordable. I would not deny that it's abundant, but when we hear about all the public health impacts that we've heard about tonight, I don't think that anyone can say that it is affordable. Thank you.
Thank you. So, you asked the question, and then just to remind everybody, the purpose of this meeting is to get comments and listen and receive feedback, but we'll work with management to post a response to your question. And also common themes from today's input session on the Flexible Path website as soon as we can. So look for it there and an answer to your question.
Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am. So I'll call to the mic Gail Gallegos and call forward Matthew Romero. Ms. Gail Williams, are you taking on?
I'm going to Facebook Live.
Okay, remind everybody again about that if you don't mind.
So I regret leaving. Very, very good comments. Very much appreciate the interest in the topic. As we reported earlier, the mayor had another session that he had to do that was in conflict. He felt very good about the fact that we were going to be taking those and following up. He stops, and he and I will start at 9 o'clock on Facebook Live discussion where we can again have more people hear about the things that we're trying to do and have another mechanism to get some input. So we are going to try as many things as possible to do that. And the mayor will ask the public more questions in that session, and we'll combine that input to what we have.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I am Gail Gallegos. I am the Executive Director for Green Spaces Alliance. Green Spaces Alliance is a small San Antonio-based and formed local nonprofit with a mission to sustain the natural environment and enhance urban green spaces through land conservation, community engagement, and education. As you have heard from all the speakers tonight, whether positive or adding their suggestions, we all want good changes to happen. But change is never as fast as we want. I know, I run a small environmental nonprofit in Texas. But I have seen firsthand CPS Energy's commitment to the environment and to our community. Through the 8 years of their partnering with Green Spaces Alliance, they have helped facilitate more than 4,000 children to connect with nature and their natural environment through our Picture Your World youth photography program. The flexible path that they have proposed acknowledges that every opportunity for new technology and faster paths to eliminate coal, CPS Energy will take those paths. It is reasonable, reliable, and cost-effective. Green Spaces commend CPS Energy on the progress they have made in being number one in solar and number one in wind. So they're the best, but you've heard, your community wants you to go faster. Green Spaces has all the faith that CPS Energy will move as quickly as possible, as fiscally possible, towards a sustainable San Antonio. I have listened to different representatives, including Ms. Paula and many others from CPS Energy, and I believe in their commitment to this community and commitment to a clean, sustainable San Antonio. I know that the flexible path is a choice that they've made, that they will make the most sustainable path forward. As technology, as new paths are revealed, Green Spaces stands in support of CPS Energy's flexible path. The right direction, the right path. We're there to help them find their ways. We want to be a partner with it, and we believe in their commitment to the environment. Thank you.
Thank you so much. now we'll call on Mike Roman. So next up is Matthew Romero, and then our last speaker is Lorena Salazar.
Well, thank you, everybody. I almost got to close it out for the evening.
Well, you might. Is Marina Salazar here? All right, you are closing.
Okay. What an honor. Thank you all for having us here this evening. And really appreciative of the community. And you really have a great, informed community here. And it's great to see the engagement. My name is Matthew Romero, and I'm Senior Director for Clear Result. It's our mandate to assist utilities in transitioning to the utility of the future, and we're so pleased to be part of CPS in that effort. In our experience, the lowest cost kilowatt is the one that doesn't need to be generated. And through conservation and the installation of higher performing or more efficient equipment from the customer. It's been a privilege for Clear Result for the last 2 years to be partnered directly with CPS Energy and bring market transformative energy efficiency programs and demand response programs to commercial, industrial, institutional, and residential customers. Through these programs, we've helped defer the use of over 100 million kilowatt hours. That's resulted in direct on-bill lasting annual energy or annual savings over $10 million to your customers, which is an impressive amount. We also heard from Ms. Gold-Williams earlier that since the inception of these programs in 2007, the direct impact that has been the avoided construction of another coal plant. And, you know, energy efficiency is one small piece of the puzzle, but we believe it's a very important one. And through these programs, over 2,000 commercial customers, including your public school districts, your municipalities, your military customers, your healthcare, and over 600 small business customers that you have participated. And it's a great privilege for us to play this small role in helping CPS Energy pursue the flexible path forward, and we support it wholeheartedly. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Are there any more registered speakers? I think we've gone through all the cards. Yes, ma'am?
Molly Moore.
Did you sign up?
Yes.
You did? Well, come forward.
I'll be brief because I think many comments have already been made that I would simply echo. But I am representing a group called Stone of the Stream, Roca and El Rio. We're a group of environmentally concerned writers and artists. We organized ourselves about 2 years ago, particularly because we're concerned about the issue of climate change and how it impacts San Antonio and indeed the global environment. I was an early participant of Wintricity and had a very shady a lot. I was never able to put solar panels on my house, but was really thrilled when CPS did the community solar, so I was able to buy some solar panels. So I also very much appreciate much of the vision that CPS has shown in terms of trying to move towards renewables. I am, however, disappointed in the flexible plan as it stands currently, because I don't feel that it's ambitious enough. I understand that it will go faster as better technologies appear, but I think you have to create a vision that galvanizes and moves you forward faster. Greg Harmon mentioned the mission to go to the moon. I think we need something like that given the realities of climate change. If CPS can be bolder and more visionary and set a goal that we will use only renewables by 2030, we will end coal by 2025. That sets an energy in motion that then moves us forward more quickly. So I really encourage CPS to be more bold. Thank you.
That's our last speaker. All right,
express the board's sincere appreciation to everyone who took time to share comments with us this evening. We realize that we manage your community's assets, and in doing so, feedback from you is vital to the success of our organization and our community's future. Members of the board, if there's no more business for today, you'll have a motion to adjourn. So the motion is to adjourn has been made by Dr. Guevara.
Second
by Mr. Kelly. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The meeting's adjourned, and the time is 8:26.